We are underfunded, overstretched, and literally under attack. The needs are going in one direction and the money is going in the other. I think I'm probably the only person in the world now who's been to Darfur, Gaza, Kupiansk, Kabul, Kandahar, Kunduz, Goma, all in the last year. And in all of those crises, I see the impact of these funding cuts, devastating impact on people's lives, on the choices they have to make, which is why we're out there saying that with only 1% of what the world spends on defense, we could save over 100 million lives. So everywhere I go, I spend a lot of time with the local teams, local organizations, local communities who really are the front line of the humanitarian response. I want to shift power to those local organizations and away from the center, away from the hierarchy. When you think about how much money is being made in the global economy right now and the threat to global stability, if we don't meet these challenges, the next pandemic, waves of migration caused by climate change, increasing numbers of people displaced, angry, without hope because of the expansion of conflict. These are all threats to the global economy. Last year, we reached over 100 million people with essential life-saving humanitarian aid. I draw hope from the sense of mission and purpose that I see in so many of our humanitarian colleagues. You know, they are facing real threats, real dangers. Last year was the most deadly year to be a humanitarian worker on record. Watch me if I try to hold them back and try to prevent them going out there to meet these challenges. There's no way I can stop them. They are determined because for them, this isn't a job, it's a vocation.
Number one, ongoing curiosity. Just read, read every day, okay? Second, humility, because a lot of the students, if you come out with a sense of confidence that you know too much, you often get surprised. And the financial markets are a very great teacher of humility. Your decisions, right or wrong, could change, and you may not know the reasons why. And third, I would ask that they cultivate as many relationships as possible, mentors, folks that can help guide them of how to succeed in whatever organization they end up working for. But in many ways, I don't know what the future is going to lie for them. It's going to be very different than when I was going through a financial services career. So the last thing I will ask is that they keep in touch with me so that I can give them some advice, but just as much I can learn from them as they succeed in their career. I remember when I first entered in my own career for banking, learning to use PowerPoint and Excel was considered you're a cream of the crop student. But you quickly learn a few years once you're in industry that these technical skills tend to get out of date very quickly. So what you do want to make sure is that you are able to learn as fast as you can and that you're keeping curious about all the changes and developments. What AI does do is help you process information quickly, but it can't define for you what are your key values that help you make decisions. And ultimately, economics and finance is about making decisions and understanding the trade-offs, but you have to determine what those trade-offs are. What I have found out is that whereas the trend of finance education was increasingly mathematical when I started learning finance, now the pendulum is starting to swing back towards a liberal education, understanding the political systems, the history, how society has evolved, because as much as you tend to think of finance as very quantitative, in fact, it's very much shaped by the actors in the market and the decisions by very strong personalities.
At the moment, most encryption systems in the world use a combination of what are known as like classical hardware, random number generators. These are based on electronic noise. So if you try to make an electronic circuit, no electronic circuit is 100% perfect. And you leverage that noisy behavior to create some randomness that you can then use. And you use that within a system that also puts it in what's known as a pseudo-random number generator. Over the past decade, we have seen multiple failures of these kind of encryption systems due specifically to the way the randomness is generated, which is pushing a lot of people to look at the next generation of solutions dependent on quantum systems. When you have a particular quantum physical system, and when you try to measure it, the outcome of that measurement is completely probabilistic. There is no way of knowing exactly what the outcome is going to be if that system is in what's known as a superposition of potential states. Every time you measure that system in superposition, you're going to get a result that you cannot predict. A quantum random number generator tries to leverage this feature to create true randomness from an actual physical process. And now randomness has a wide range of applications. The most important of which, and the ones that we focus on at Quantum Dice, are in cybersecurity, where randomness is basically the fundamental core of every single cryptographic protocol that exists. And the other side of it is within probabilistic and stochastic computational methods, where randomness is the fundamental driver of these computational paradigms. Our quantum random number generator has the unique ability to do a continuous evaluation and assurance in real time of the randomness that's being produced, which is a feature that no existing classical system can reproduce. This gives you a level of assurance and a level of verification on the security of your system that we didn't have before.